what we did. So you tell a lot about somebody by the hymns they sing. We have been talking about the glory that Jesus has in God's church. When he returns, how he is to manifest that glory in us in our everyday life. That's what we talked about last week. And tonight we're going to continue in 2 Thessalonians. But before we do, I want to kind of give you a little bit of word study that goes along with what we did last week. I guess I'll put this on. Some things are there for ornamentation only. That this is one of them. The New Testament, we talk about the New Testament word for glory is doxa, which is where we get our doxology, the glory word, the praise word. It is the translation in the Old Testament of a Hebrew word, kavod or kavod. And it is specifically called the kavod of Yahweh. And it is at first in the Old Testament located with or in one principal phenomenon. And later on it is transferred from that phenomenon into an abstract. Whereby it means a whole lot more. And we find it in the book of Exodus, but there is actually a song written about the Kavod Yahweh, or the glory of God. It is called the Thunderstorm Song. Psalm 29. Take your Bibles. Psalm 29. Because what is interesting is that the ancient Hebrews, not necessarily every storm, that's not what they meant, but the ancient Hebrews saw the revealing of the glory of God in the thunderstorm more than any other phenomenon. Now you can imagine why that is so. We're talking about desert dwellers or semi-desert dwellers for the most part. We're talking about people who really had a desire and understanding of the value of water, because at least from Jerusalem southward, there is so little of it. And so there's this real value of water that comes into play in the Old Testament, which is why very early on in the Bible, we have the word of life is the water of life. And water, so you can do a word study on water, and water plays a significant role within the scripture of how it translates over symbolically. And that's because we're talking about people who were shepherds in an arid land, or even into the desert from Beersheba on down to Egypt. So they very early, recognizing the value of water, recognizing the value of the thunderstorm, they were also farmers as well as herdsmen, but there was also some grain growers. And they realized, whether they made the connection or not, they realized that when there is a thunderstorm that rolls through, there's a significant difference in what the crops look like in the morning compared to what there is if there's simply a rain that comes through. And the reason, of course, for that, we now understand the phenomenon, is because in a lightning storm, nitrogen falls with the water to the ground. That the primary source of nitrogen in the ground is from lightning storms. If you just have a regular storm that comes through, man, the grass looks nice and green the next morning. But if you have a thunderstorm that rolls through, the next morning there is a significant difference in the way everything looks. So very early on, they began to explore the idea that God is revealed in a very significant fashion in the thunderstorm, lightning storm. The more horrific the lightning, the more the revelation or the revealing of God. Now, that does not mean, as I said, does not mean that God was revealed in every thunderstorm, or that God is related to every thunderstorm, but they began to make that connection. So, when they come out of Egypt and they go to the mountain of God where Moses goes up to receive the tablets, what happens? There's a thunderstorm, there's clouds, there's lightning. Don't touch this mountain. God is present. Thessalonians chapter 1. Just a quick comment. And because we've been doing some different kind of stuff as we usually do in the summertime. We've already had one get-together celebration. Bible school, we're going to have another one this next week. You know, as I was even driving here tonight, and it kind of came back to recognition. Number one, there are a whole lot of churches that don't even have Sunday night service at all anymore, anytime. And if they don't have Sunday night, you can bet for sure they don't have a Wednesday night worship service. But then even those of us who do have Sunday night and Wednesday night service all over the county, it's amazing how many of them cancel Sunday night services for the duration of summer. Now I'm going to tell you, I love Sunday night. I love Wednesday night. And if it's just me and one of you, we're going to have Sunday night service and we're going to have Wednesday night service. I recognize that there are people that are going to be out of town this summer. All of y'all are probably going to be out of town sometime this summer. That's okay. Great. We don't have our biggest crowd in summertime.
Right now, where we
throughout our lives, we have been celebrating Jesus. And yet, the Bible says, as Thomas Aquinas explains to us, that God is greater than anything I can imagine. That whatever in my mind, based upon Scripture, that I can imagine about God, God is so much more than that. My finite mind cannot begin to embrace all that God in Christ is. And so Paul says, let me tell you what's going to happen. And I love the way he describes it. When the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God. I mean, when Jesus comes with myriads of his angel army and appears where everyone on this planet can see him all at once. All at once. Those who are alive, those who have been dead. Every single one of us gets to see Jesus split the Easter sack. And when we do, on that day, regardless of how long we've been a Christian, regardless of how long we've been studying the Scripture, regardless how long we've been dedicated to the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says he's not only going to be glorified in us, the Bible says that we are going to marvel. We are going to, as the old hymn says, stand amazed in the presence of Jesus. Because he is so far beyond anything we could have ever imagined. When I thought about that, I began to think about some of the Scripture that I knew of, and I was thinking specifically, what is it that we're going to marvel at? And what are we going to marvel at? Well, the first thing, and this is an Old Testament thought, the first thing that we're going to marvel at is we're going to marvel at the beauty of Christ. Take your Psalms and look with me. First of all, there's three of them I want you to see. Psalm 27, the one right, two right before the thunder song. Psalm 27. Look at what it says in verse number four. One thing I have asked of the Lord that I will seek after. One thing that I have asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all of the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. He didn't say, man, I want to see the pearly gates and the golden streets. He didn't say, I want to gaze on the gorgeousness of heaven as it is described and displayed, particularly in the book of the Revelation of St. John the Divine. No, he said, I desire to seek the Lord, and I desire one day to just sit and marvel at the beauty. with the body, from the body, is to be present with the Lord. We preached and talked about the intermediate state before. That when I close my eyes in death, I am there in the presence of Almighty God. I know that. Jesus promised the thief on the cross, this day you will be with me in paradise. And yet, everyone's included in this passage in 2 Thessalonians that when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords shows up in the great return, not only is he going to be glorified in us all, the living and the dead, because the dead are going to be raised, but everybody together is going to mark him. That's something that's beyond what I can fathom. I mean, those who've already been in his presence, somehow or another, on that day, there's going to be a renewedness. Maybe it's because they're going to be in their new resurrected bodies. I don't know. But what I do know, and I do believe, is what the Scripture says. And the Scripture says is that all of us together will be returning tomorrow. My hands are wild. We're going to marvel at the Lord Jesus. And I believe, first of all, that refers to you. We're going to be absolutely amazed that the all-powerful God at just how beautiful he is. Think about think about that thing which beauty-wise astounds you the most. For some of us, it's something in nature. For others, it may be a great work of art. For still others, it may be a great work of architecture or the like. Something that is so astounding that it simply takes your breath away. The whole church, our breath's going to be taken away by the beauty of the Lord. We're going to marvel. I think we're going to marvel at his beauty. I think that we're going to marvel at his power. That's the reference here when he comes with all of these myriads, with his angel army, these myriads of angels. I think with all the power that we have seen in our lifetimes, and we've seen some great acts of power in the natural world, I do believe that when God shows up, we're going to say, we had never seen anything. We thought we had witnessed power. We've never witnessed. Till God in Christ Jesus shows up on that last day. I think we're going to be marveling and astounded at his beauty. I think we're going to be marveled at his power. But more than his beauty and his power, I think we're going to be marveled at the fact that such an awesome God was willing to cast off his beauty and all his majestic power to go to the cross to save sinners like us. I think that we are going to stand marveled, speechless before the Lord that any of us, particularly ourselves, and I believe on that day that it will start with us a new journey with God, and it will be something that we never get over. Because I don't know about you, but I'm giving confession and being honest. Have there ever been times, well, we usually say it like this in our life, that there are some times that we're just really passionate, hot for God, and there's other times that we're not as passionate, maybe life gets in the way, or whatever it may be, or maybe sin gets in the way. But the truth of the matter is, the way that we can say that, and you'll hear evangelists in particular use this kind of language. That, have you ever met anybody that got over meeting Jesus? Well, to be honest, every single one of us probably has at some point in our lives. Because the way we say it is, we're just not as hot or on fire for God as we used to. I'm just not as close to God as I used to be. I'm not walking as close to God. Whatever it may be, whatever language we want to use, what we mean is, we got over meeting Jesus. On that great day, and from that great day forward, we will never, ever again get over meeting Jesus. The most beautiful one in the whole entire universe, filled with more power than the universe can contain. I know how black my sins have been and how dark they've been. I know